Okay. Welcome, Balbir, and welcome everyone to the third event and the first edition of student presentation of the student meet, the second edition of student meet and student meet 2021. So we have with us Balbir Singh Aulak, the doctoral student at the School of Research Methodology at TISS. So his study is titled Interlinkages of Politics, Land and Sports, on the case of Mumbai Metropolitan Region. It explores the primary research question of what changes have emerged in the way the land for sports have been used and mediated by politics, and what does this reveal about the urban transformation in Mumbai Metropolitan Region. The objective of the study is to understand the actions and context in which the urban politicians pursue sports and land as tools of conducting political activities and generating the political capital. So I think, Balbir, it's over to you. I'll just stop sharing and you can start sharing your presentation.
Okay, great. Okay. Right. Am I audible and my screen is visible, right?
Yes, Balbir. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, great. So just to like very briefly introduce myself, I basically, in the context of the study that I'm discussing today, when I joined TISS 2 years back, we had this very broad idea about looking at urbanization and sports. So the whole title sort of came together when we understood that both sports and urbanization today require land to proceed further. And this is something that is a very contemporary understanding and a very basic one when we saw the kind of transformations that were being done in the context of Mumbai and especially the authorities that were taking charge. So whether it's regard to the coastal road project where we require more land for transportation or whether we require more land for housing. So and like the relationship with land and urbanization sort of is very common, and we kind of thought that in the broader sense, how does aspects of culture then play a role, right? Like in the aesthetic political domain. So we kind of brought this title together and yeah, to discuss it in the context of both the Bombay Municipal Corporation as well as in the context of Thane, and particularly like in the regional context of Mumbai, which is why the title is, and the research area entirely is the Mumbai metropolitan region and not just specific to Mumbai, where a lot of aspects such as peri-urbanization and even to, in another sense, subaltern urbanism and those kinds of themes could be captured. So this is what broadly the title is. And yeah, I would just directly move on to the presentation now. So what I will try to do today is just to brief. So this particular study firstly is ongoing and is in the stage where I've completed my data collection work, and I'm trying to mainly look at I'm collating data from different sources that I've gathered, and now moving towards transcription and analysis and then to the writing part of it. So what I will do is I will briefly introduce the topic, what kind of themes that have come out in the literature review process, what has been my theoretical framework, basis on which my case selection as well as sampling and also case design has happened, then a methodology itself, what kind of design that I've particularly picked up in order to conceptualize different themes. The third is the sampling and data collection plan. So my selection of cases basically happened at two levels, both at a thematic level and then like moving into deeper sort of cases which were actually selection of certain plots as to understand the transformation over time and place. The third is what kind of internal sampling that I did when I actually moved into like following a case, right, over time, what kind of internal sampling that was done. How I'm trying to design my cases now with a lot of data points that I have, the data analysis plan, and I will just very briefly like sort of share what my reading list was like moving into the study and what I'm currently doing. Okay, so firstly, just to very briefly introduce my topic, right? So when I started, I was specifically looking at sports from two particular angles. One is the sport of cricket and football. How do these two particular sports have played out in the case of urban transformation, right? And when I looked at land, I specifically looked at the concept of recreation space, other common open spaces, which gets transformed and then converted into these sort of public open spaces. And the third is in itself, the places that have already been transformed into organized green spaces, which we know like can be categorized as parks, gardens, or even like more organized spaces like stadiums, for example, or clubhouses or gymkhanas. So the first step, as I mentioned, like very briefly in the previous slide, is that I kind of tried to come together with this idea that these three things are or could be studied together, primarily because we have always been talking about politics and sports, politics and land politics when we talk about the real estate sector, and particularly in the context of Bombay as well, because of the high value of land and the further commodification that has happened over the period, right? And then we also kind of have this gap in literature, which is kind of filling up right now, where sports and land are basically like put together as, variables to understand how does that relationship work out. And which is why we kind of hypothesized this thing where we can probably look at the centerlink and does the centerlink firstly exist as well? First establish that, and if it does, in what cases or circumstances or context or in what time frame? So what we had in mind was we were looking at urban transformations at the end of the day, but what we were also trying to focus on was looking at this particular case, if whatever the case is, at different time frames. It wasn't just one transformation, so as to say, from a barren land into a sports complex, for example. It was also prior to that, perhaps when the rural to urban process is taking place, perhaps in areas like Meera Bhayandar, or for example in Thane, or for example in Vasai Virar, or for example in Navi Mumbai. So, I mean, when the land distribution itself started happening, or even in cases like land reclamation. So these kinds of processes were basically involved and trying to capture, okay, what these three things kind of represent. Then what we moved into the next step was looking at, okay, what kind of political capital are we talking about here? So we kind of fixated the value of land in the political context as to how politicians have this and also people who practice politics per se, right? It may not be politicians directly. Of course, a large chunk of them are everyday politicians, but also people who contest and do some sort of politics, and where land becomes this central sort of space in which these contestations happen, or these popular sort of protests happen, or where a lot of activism happens. So what is this kind of political capital that is generated around land in MMR was a large part of our initial understanding, moving closer to understanding, okay, what kind of urban transformation are we talking about when we say that these interlinks are there. Then we kind of focused our way to how sports and land is linked, in the way that, of course, cricket and football, the two sports that I've selected, are primarily primarily require land as a basic component to play on. So access and availability of land becomes very important. And the way in which land then gets organized and then have implications further for these sports, particularly when these sort of sports move from rural to semi-urban to urban context, and then to, for example, becoming part of the global city region, which is what MMRs is. So yeah, so this was basically the slow sort of process that we went through to kind of capture, okay, what kind of urban, like make a sense out of what urban transformation that we are talking about. Based on the literature review, what the stuff that I basically came up with was, in terms of consequences for urban transformation, we certain themes such as commodification, commercialization of land was a very important sort of implication that we saw, particularly not just due to the high rise of real estate value, but as I mentioned previously, the increasing interest of different groups at different levels of organization in society and community to actually assert their rights in one way, or to claim some sort of legitimacy through access of land and to attain any sort of service, for example, thereafter. So commodification and commercialization to that end of land was very central to how we actually saw the urban transformation process happening. Like in the past 20 odd years, when we see a large number of, for example, Nagar Panchayats kind of becoming full throttle corporations. So, I mean, we kind of try to understand that as well when we say, okay, there's a commodification, there's further organization of space over here within the region. With regards to cricket and football particularly as well, it was also linked to some sort of capital formation, because then land became a central sort of idea over here. Where in cricket, I looked at commodification and commercialization in the way cricket has now moved into more of a popular culture, particularly in the past 20, 25 years. Like, several people have written extensively about cricket, the role and advent of television in the middle class, and also due to the role that different youth groups at the very local level have played in kind of trickling down cricket, and therefore making availability and access to grounds possible for these sort of clubs, sort of groups, which are in a lot of ways male dominant. There is, of course, a lot of gap in literature with regards to access of women, girls to playing spaces, and not just in cricket and football, but generally across the play culture in India. So, I mean, there are certain literature and we kind of did look at it, but primarily because the work was inadequate so as to represent a broader theme, we did identify it as a very major gap, particularly the access of girls basically to playing spaces, especially to even small spaces of play, where girls are still are into spaces which are more intimate, more personal to them, more, and they have a very different kind of perhaps conceptualization of what public space then becomes. And it also kind of ringed a bell to us that how open spaces then get conceptualized in the very broader policy sense. And then when we talk about access of girls to these spaces. So, of course, then representation, access to play, social organization automatically became relevant themes that came out. Spaces also became symbols as to naming, for example, certain grounds in a certain way, having some sort of social history towards of a particular community or a club to a certain ground were some of the themes that came out of the literature. A large part of the football literature was mainly written about mega events in sports and how urban planning is linked to these large-scale sporting events, where football is used as symbolic capital by politicians to basically have some sort of positive impact within that one particular time frame. Again, what we continuously saw was a lot of the work was done within one particular time frame and it wasn't over time. So that was certainly the case when we looked at sports and urban transformation specifically and the role politicians and land transformation particularly played. In the case of Mumbai, we did have a particular study that came out in the election period, which focused on how different kinds of political groups and youth wings of these political groups organize these sports events closer or after the or near the winter season for youth, to basically mobilize youth and more importantly male youth. So I mean there was some study there was one study to that end as well, and reading more into it, this is something that we kind of figured out in football. So when it came to land, this is an extensively written upon topic from numerous perspectives. What we kind of focused and narrowed down on was literature particularly pertaining to Mumbai and also to places where which have some sort of similarity in terms of population and size. So there were studies that were written in the context of Bangalore or, for example, Hyderabad or even Delhi were taken into account, but a large part was studies based on Mumbai and the Mumbai metropolitan region. So there is a line of study from 2000 to 2010, perhaps, which critiques the neoliberal perspective of planning different corporations which came up post 2000 in the Mumbai region. So with regards to housing, whether it's regards to resettlement of people, whether it's regards to poor service delivery when it comes to the corporations, again, the capacities and so on and so forth. So of course, there was a lot of literature around that how land basically got transformed in this public sector. And of course, we did some sort of review study of the laws that eventually came in as well and what kind of a policy framework is around land in Mumbai region. So to understand special purpose authorities which basically were in charge of distributing land when it came to places like New Bombay, when it came to CIDCO, for example. So, I mean, we did kind of look at it in that sense as to how land got distributed in the previous periods and what kind of rural processes were involved in these little micro transformations that happened every day, for example. So there was there was literature on peripheral politics as well when it came to cases like New Bombay or which is Navi Mumbai, or for example when it came to Vasai Virar or Meera Bhayandar. So we also had specific some sort of dialogue at this point, and this was the first time we actually started talking about the study to people. So these people were primarily because of my background and some sort of relevant contacts at the corporation level. Because of my background working with the Election Commission, I had some sort of direct contacts with the corporations as well as the Urban Development Department in the government of Maharashtra. So I kind of reached out to specific people who were part of town planning and kind of understood from them as to like this is what my study is, and I wanted to understand land transformation initially, that how did it happen. So I got a lot of hints and themes that okay, this was the right kind of literature. So this is where the first process of sort of dialogue building happened with directly the officers, like the government officers particularly. And yeah, so then we kind of, what we did was, because we felt that we were on the right track to actually figure out the right kind of literature, because we were also kind of extrapolating over here to some end, where we looked at these interlinks in one way and what did it reveal then about urban transformation at a broader structural and a systematic level. So what we used was what I particularly use is Michael Borovey's extended case method, where I look at and understand to conceptualize in a lot of ways political actions of political leaders that use sports and land in specific context, as I mentioned, and to further understand what politicians actually do, like in reality, how does this process start? Where does like certain knowledge systems begin, at least, like, because those kind of studies are really not available, and this biographical sort of approach, right, where one has to move beyond like this idea of service delivery and what kind of redistribution is happening. What we actually kind of did was have a biographical approach to actually understanding each case deeper and deeper. So to understand what politicians and people around them actually did so that the place was captured and perhaps some changes were made, whether it's legal, whether it's illicit, or whatever it is. Accounting for real events, struggles, and the kind of, so your drama basically means the kind of struggles that we associate with land. So kind of understanding popular sort of struggles where we have dharnas and, for example, even sort of marches against particular political leaders or even the corporation, right? Which is something that we also, I also captured when I was doing my field work. So using this sort of methodology gave me a chance to actually link a lot of layers that are there within each story and then move very fluidly between one theme to another. So the extended case method basically allows me to do that because it links the micro and macro processes that are involved. So that is one of the primary reasons to pick the case, this particular type of case study method. What also the case extended case method is based on is Giddings structuration theory. So when Giddings basically talks about the duality of structure, where he talks about the structure agent relationship and how they both in turn like change each other. So in this way, we also kind of were figuring out that who are these agents, right? Whether it's in the direct, who are these direct politicians, or they are also people around them, or are there people who kind of want to enter the political domain and then they sort of work this sort of interlink where they use sports, where they use the where they use land to capture some sort of capital. So Giddings' work basically helped us a lot to kind of establish some sort of exploration as well into the between politics, land, and sports, and also how politicians basically appropriate this power, negotiate, and even legitimize these spaces eventually, right? Which is something that I will hopefully will give an example when I move to one of the particular cases, that how legitimation happens when a politician is given the right kind of resources at his disposal. So, and how does this get this generate into capital, right? This was very helpful in a way to establish, because the structuration approach kind of allows for this kind of a flexibility when it comes to understanding the relationship approach between agents and structures. So because we were particularly dealing with some form of structure over here, and also places specifically when we picked up, when we were kind of understanding also what kind of cases then we have to pick up. So automatically what we had was in relation to use of the structuration approach based on the reflexive science model, what Borovey talks about, is that the scope of capital and particularly political capital is very important to the political field. That is, so drawing from Borovey's work in the work of field, right, the field theory, and how the field then in turn gets captured, what Borovey basically talks about structured structures and structuring structures. So this was very similar to what Giddings talks about when he speaks about the duality of the structure. So what these structures are, how do they get formed, what is the level of organization at each stage in time? Those were the kinds of nitty-gritties that we kind of wanted to have, or the complexity I wanted to have in my theoretical framework, so that it gave a lot of emphasis on what was coming from the field and we could kind of make sense out of it. So complexity theory specifically bridges one gap which is there in Bourdieu's concept of habitus and even field, is that it particularly accounts for agenda setting. So Bourdieu doesn't account for a specific agenda per se. Complexity theory basically combines structuration and the concept of habitus and then develops or helps in sort of understanding that these kinds of spaces, right? How does knowledge systems then get interacted? And how do we then move forward? Of course, then practice, what kind of practices are then involved, of course, then helps sort of mitigate how knowledge systems then get translated into everyday practices. And of course, knowledge network analysis then becomes the next part and parcel as to how stakeholders get mapped and at what stage and time. So just moving quickly, like these are primarily my research questions, as it was also mentioned in the introduction. What changes have emerged in the way sports and land are mediated by politics, and what does it reveal about urban transformation in Mumbai? This is primarily my research question as to locating these two particular sort of variables in the context of the urban transformation debate that is currently there in the metropolitan region. Some of these other questions that I looked at were what patterns are revealed through varied cases about the relationship of politics with land and how sports is used as a tool or conduit. Here the objective was to basically trace patterns and identify cases so as to basically reveal, the relationships. This was also largely done through, at the initial stage, through newspaper reports and interviews with a few key informants. Also, primary objective over here was about understanding the spatial characters, right, by which certain politicians gets associated with certain kinds of lands, right, and how these sort of interlinks across geography happen, and at what time frame does one level of politician come in and the other goes out, right, because it basically then becomes something that is beyond one's capacity to sort of manage, because when it comes to aspects more closer to the environment, politicians who have a higher degree of authority, right, automatically become key players as to mitigate risks and also like sort of move into these networks with the police department, or even for example with the corporation, the collector office, and the tehsildar office under the collector. So, those are the kind of things that we were sort of hoping for. Yeah, with this research question. Yeah. So, just one second. Yeah. So, the third one was how do these patterns differ from like in cricket and football? And we kind of hope to get very specific sort of cases when we actually started off with this question, and we have like sort of moved away from this as well, but what we have done is sort of bring together pieces where the change within those sports are at least captured, if not very specifically sort of getting an answer to okay, what do these patterns in nature differ as. So that is one way that we have kind of mitigated this particular question from the field. So how are these patterns basically varied in terms of scales of politics and transcend into interrelationships? As I basically just mentioned in my last slide as well, that how do these patterns firstly emerge? What kind of level of organizations do they require for emerging firstly? At what stage are they at this point of time? And how have they basically brought some sort of legitimacy over time, if they have, been able to do so. Yeah. So the other one was basically sort of looking at over here. Just one second. Yeah. So the other was basically sort of looking at what do these interrelationships reveal about nature, particularly whether it's formal, informal, legal, illegal, what do we call as legal, what do we call as informal, what gets constituted as a formal sort of space, what does get substituted as an informal space as well, right? Because these are the kinds of patterns that we have been seeing in the literature that was published. So, yeah. So broadly explaining the research design as well, right? Like, so when I use the extended case method using the structuration approach by Giddings, the study basically looked at and identified like some sort of key aspects, which were like the community as a cultural base, right, where sports is basically played and used. The other was the civic politics, the third being urbanization itself from like different standpoints and strands, like the subaltern one, and having peri-urbanization, the neoliberal approach perhaps, right? And also looking, the primary aim was to look at perspectives that haven't been previously captured, which is why we kind of brought together these three sort of elements together. So, yeah. So the fourth was obviously the sports itself, what kind of implications did it have on that, and how it in turn describes certain urban processes that are broadly discussed in the cultural and aesthetic space. So the fifth element is the politician himself or herself, right? As to what kind of role do they play in this process of transformation. The ECM explores structures through everyday practices and situation analysis at a micro level as the basis of any analysis. This situated knowledge can be useful in understanding strategies that are devised to use land and sports and what it reveals about the trends and patterns. What urban transformation then? Yeah. So, when it comes to sampling and data collection, right, like the sampling method was theoretical sampling, and this was again used specifically in the extended case method as well, where it kind of draws a lot from what the theory sort of, what is the broader theory that we are moving sort of building towards. Like, I mean, as more and more sort of data kind of comes in, right? Like what kind of theory building is happening, and which is why we use theoretical sampling in this case. My primary sources were politician, intermediaries working in politics, sports, caretakers of open spaces in MMR, government officials, government offices, semi-government organizations, which were like a special purpose authority, if that's the case, sports bodies, the district football bodies, the district sports organizations, and also a lot of public and private businesses and NGOs. I mean, these are my primary sources in one way. These weren't my key informants. My key informants were something that I will discuss when I discuss these cases in particular. My secondary sources included kind of understanding what has been the formal setup for cricket and football in MMR, the specific data on the status of public open spaces, activities around these spaces which are led by NGOs or even private sort of individuals, and a lot in a number of cases by very renowned politicians as well. So relevant development plans automatically became important sources of data when I initially started. Policies related to open spaces, central government guidelines, state government guidelines, district level policies about open spaces, all became like relevant to the use. So now specifically moving to the case, right? So of course, the steps that were involved in selection was first was a thorough literature review process. The second was just like going on Google Earth, right? And just kind of understanding, okay, what the typology is, like where are the environmentally sensitive zones located, where are most of these grounds located, right? Where what is located in MMR, and what characteristics frame the scene of the plot. So is a plot located near a lot of towers, or is it located in a slum, or is it adjacent to an encroachment? Is it nearer to a creek, for example? Is it outside the main sort of dense populated areas? What is the scene of the plot? Then basically mapping these types of cases. So for mapping, what I primarily did was sort of use Microsoft Excel. Okay. So what kind of practices were mainly there? Writing it all down into Excel, what kind of a plot it is, what is the location, what kind of transformation can we see from Google Earth, because we could get time series data, like looking from 2000 onwards. The criteria for selection was mainly diversity, asking the question, does it capture a particular type of transformation that is unique in its own way? The third was discussing these themes that were previously looked at, right? Whether it came to the issue of environment, or whether it was concern related to large open spaces being in sort of short supply. So, I mean, these kind of issues that were previously there in the literature were kind of also captured when looking or as a selection criteria. Now, so these are broadly sort of understanding what were the shifts in uses of this land, what were the types of shifts, what were the types of shifts in groups that were in and around, what were the shifts in control, where was there a change of ownership that led to a certain kind of organizational change on the land, then what kind of capital structures and values were then associated when there was a change, for example, or shift. So these are the kinds of themes that then again automatically became part of the case selection process, which of course came through a lot from literature. So the cases that I eventually selected were, one was the Thane police ground, in which was a case of land reclamation and distribution. The land was reclaimed and then distributed out to the Thane police. The second was the TMC sports complex. Again, this was a case of land transformation from like a mangrove patch to a plain land where a sports complex had come up, and also a case very closely linked to political patronage because there was a direct politician involved, which we could establish at least. Then there was this particular case of a mosque in Dharavi, which is called the Nuruddha Masjid, where you have a particular a maidan or a space, right, which is almost 80 by 100 square feet at best. But that's the only open space where you have a lot of activities ongoing. So the other, this was a case of, again, land reclamation because it's in Dharavi and political patronage as well, as to how different politicians then kind of use this community space. And of course, how then it turn gets translated as well through the mosque, because the mosque is the one who is controlling that piece of land. The other is the St. Xavier's ground, which is the only authorized open space that I'm looking at, which is a large public open space. Yeah. So what I was saying was this is the only large open space that was there in my entire study, which is a designated open space and has been there for the past 60-70 years. This is also the home to the Mumbai District Football Association. The other is this particular club in 7-Eleven. Okay. Yeah, so the other is the 7-Eleven club that is there. I have a very short sort of video perhaps on each case. So this is particularly the Thane police ground. And if you could see my mouse pointer, the police bharti ground, which is what it is called. How has it transformed from mangrove patch into like a physical ground is something that can be seen here, if you can. Yeah. This is very similar to what we can also see in the Thane sports complex case as well. These are again designated spaces where you can see on the reservation map you have a stadium and also you have a recreation ground. This is something that is not the case with the Thane police ground. It is not a designated space, as you saw. The Nuruluna Masjid, this is the space that is what I'm talking about. You can see different images, and on the right side, this is the mosque actually, and this is the space that is actually only available. So these pictures kind of, so this is basically the open space that is out there, and all of this are then just houses around the place. So you have these maps to basically illustrate what the typology mainly is. This is the St. Xavier's ground. It's a large open space in the central space of Dadar. And I mean, this is the 7-Eleven club. It was previously a contested mangrove patch, and there's a lot of issues and how this sort of five-star sports club has now come up in Meera Bhayandar is something that I'm kind of trying to look at, which was previously a land of the Agri Koli community in Meera Bhayandar, and now how this particular plot of land has been transformed into a club, and what then it reveals about these themes when it comes to having these five-star clubs in places like Meera Bhayandar, where people usually cannot afford like a 12 lakh 11 lakh membership fees to these clubs. So yeah, I mean, so I will directly move to my case design. So so within the internal sampling framework, right, like the step one was to actually key informants were established through environment-based NGOs, journalists, and municipal corporation employees that I could get a hold of, determine one person who knows about their issue, and they're just moving slowly and snowballing into different references and people who would be ready to give an interview, and then sort of map these with relevant RTI documents, understanding the ownership, the different permissions that were allowed, to sort of map these transformations from one phase to another. Increasing the scope of interviews is something that I'm currently doing, where I'm looking at the everyday use, like if one place has now been transformed completely, what is the kind of use and what is the everyday use and how has it changed over time? The case design particularly looks at three aspects. One is the history of the land, second is the activities, and third is the people. History of the land mainly from what date, month, year to what date, month, year do you have we have the information of the land and so on and so forth. Activities, when, what happened based on the timeline we have created, ownership and so on and so forth. And then the names, like people who basically have come up, whose names have come up, allegations and acquisition that are being put on someone and so on and so forth. What kind of different records have different names? So what primary data, what can be the primary data, what can be the secondary data were then established. This is what largely my design data sources were: oral narratives, Google Earth images, development plans, additional map, GIS data, old images. So in terms of storing all of this data, what I have done primarily is create a separate folder firstly for each case, and then having a separate folder again for each of these data points. So every time I get a new piece of information, I just directly store it into this particular folder, and then also like chalk down everything in an Excel sheet as to what person I'm talking to, how many interviews have been done, what kind of nature of deliverables am I expecting from a person, and when is the next interview scheduled for. So there were multiple rounds of interviews I've been able to do across these five cases, about 43 interviews, which are people directly associated with the case and who have been part of this transformation process. So yeah, so my data analysis plan is basically now to move into transcribing and then coding this data, sort of building on a case by case basis. So depicting all of this as a story format. What is the story of transformation in the case of the Nurul Huda Masjid, for example, in Dharavi, or what is the case, for example, in the case of Mirabai Andar or Thane or in Mumbra? And what does it then it reveal about broader structural and historical perspectives about these places and the kind of themes that sort of emerge from data? Yeah, I think so. This is primarily my reading list, and which basically captures a lot of the things that I've also spoken about. Yeah, so it would be great. I mean, like, if so, I'm done my presentation. It would be great if we can, like, basically talk or discuss. I mean, yeah, so.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Thank you so much, Balbir. I think we have few more, some more questions.
Okay. Yeah.
Ekta. So the first is, what was the inspiration to conduct this study?
Okay. So primarily, so I was basically an undergrad in journalism, where I worked in the field of covering local sports. And when I actually moved into election commission in my master's, when I was pursuing my master's in public policy, I kind of linked these two things, where I was looking at, okay, evidence of sports in elections. So when I got an opportunity to actually apply at TISS, I felt, okay, this could be something that could be developed into some sort of a actual research because of the resources and understanding that TISS has about Bombay. So, I mean, this was primarily my inspiration to that end. So, yeah, I'll take the second question as a heart. Right. So what I did was, a lot of my first year actually went into doing my literature review part. So luckily I got my supervisor finalized very quickly. So that helped a lot. And we directly moved into the literature review work. And the first year entirely went into sort of identifying the correct kind of literature. And also then, what kind of key informants are we looking at? And because I did have some sort of experience with people in this field, in corporations, in local level politics, because of my exposure at the election commission, it really helped me kind of very quickly identify, okay, what kind of people should I talk to firstly. So the first year entirely went into that, and then kind of moved into, because of the pandemic, from March to June, July, and even up till August, we kind of didn't have any work done. But what I did was kind of finalize all these cases, looking at Google Earth data and news reports and news articles. So we identified all the cases. And so we basically just moved into figuring out these key informants when the lockdown actually opened up. And it was very helpful for me in one way, because the NGOs that I reached out to were very thorough in the work that they had originally done. So I was lucky enough that the cases I had selected were also in one form or the other popular when I actually really explored them in further. So a lot of people were eager to talk about it and so on and so forth. So, I mean, it helped me with the interview process very well. Of course, there were a lot of roadblocks, because I haven't spoken to some of the very important people who are higher sort of up the political ladder, which is something that I intend to do now because I have that amount of information to discuss. So, yeah. So a particular case in my research is primarily a particular plot that gets transformed. So in each of the cases, there is a specific plot that I've taken up. So then sort of determine, okay, what is the specific, and the reason for taking up that particular plot is because of the diverse nature it represents in the case. So now when I particularly pick up a case, I want to look at land reclamation. Of course, those kind of land reclamations can only happen nearer the creeks, for example, or coastal areas. So when I was actually looking at the map, sort of then figuring out, okay, this is a particular piece of plot that I can look at, or this is a particular location, or this is a particular club that I can look at. So this is what a particular case then automatically represents. the diversity here comes in the way that these themes are sort of mapped out. So whether it's a land reclamation case along with a distribution one, whether it's directly linked to political patronage where a direct politician has been involved in one way to transform that piece of land. The other was authorized, unauthorized occupancy. So, I mean, these were the broad themes. We like sort of shortlisted around 50, 55 cases across MMR and then finalized within these themes, these five cases. The particular challenge that I face with data management at this point of time is the issue of images, videos, some sort of validity to particular types of memories when people recollect in interviews, because I do take support from some sort of Landsat data where data is available through GIS to actually establish whether there was a mangrove, for example, in the case of Meera Bhayandar or no. But this sort of issue is there, and then it becomes difficult to sort of manage, okay, which person should I talk to next, which person should be validating this and validating that, because you might require an environmental expert to sort of validate a claim like that. So figuring out someone from the MCZMA, which is the Coastal Regulatory Management Authority of Maharashtra. So I mean, these are the kinds of challenges that I'm currently facing when I'm closing towards my interviews. Yeah. So with regards to coding and themes, right? So I'm in the process of transcribing my interviews at this point. I didn't do it while I was interviewing, which is a practice that is supported and being taught. But the issue with me was because I was going so much back and forth between cases, it was, and there was no sort of linear pattern because I didn't know which person I was speaking to tomorrow. The person would just call me up and say, okay, hi, if you're free, like you can come. And most of the time, of course, because of the pandemic, yeah, we had like the health risk as well to actually go and talk to these people in person, because these topics are pretty sensitive and people do like to talk about it in person. They are much more comfortable as well. And it was very helpful for me that the key informants that I had selected were in very good positions to actually explain the people at the ground what kind of an intention that I was carrying. That I wasn't politically motivated in some way, that the information that they gave me would be used to like a benefit a particular political faction, because these are the kinds of cases that I'm kind of dealing with. So yeah, so I have met politicians regularly, spoken to different levels, spoken to leaders of oppositions in the corporations, spoken to different corporators. They have been very forthcoming, because once they realize, so this is what my personal experience was, once they actually understand ki, okay, there's no hidden agenda behind it, this is purely for a research purpose, they actually helped me file a lot of RTIs as well, that you can particularly ask for this. This is the particular section that you can probably look at. So the intention was, I mean, is very, very much important for me. And that kind of really helped me and ease my way in building these relationships very quickly, actually. So, so I do know a very functional level of Marathi, but because I am from Maharashtra, I am from Mumbai specifically, native from Mumbai, so I know Marathi and I can read Marathi, and that is the reason I could do a lot of documentation translation as well that I received under RTI. So a lot of people that I actually spoke to, right, were not very fixated on the language part of it, that they were only Marathi speaking, because if you look at the cases, those were also diverse. So there weren't only Marathi speaking pockets that I was targeting. So the Nur ul Huda Masjid has a population which is completely Hindi speaking, because a lot of Muslims were like using that particular space, and the other everyday uses were by children, for example. Not a lot of Marathi speaking population was there. In the case of Meera Bhayandar, right, the Agri Koli community, which was there a part of, they were also very well versed in speaking in Hindi, and they did explain certain parts in Marathi to me, and which is why I always recorded the interviews with their consent. We were speaking in person, so I was always comfortable in telling them, you can definitely go into whatever language mode you want during the interviews. And I mean, I would then eventually transcribe, and like, if there's anything, I can of course always come back to you and get clarity from you. So the relationship was very flexible in that way. And yeah, people were opening up, because what I really felt was people actually wanted their stories to be reflective of how these spaces basically came together, what kind of ideas they did, that they had. So the Nur al-Huda Masjid case, for example, the one of the key persons that I spoke to, and he was apparently the only one living right now, was the person who was the mosque's Maulana. Okay, so he was the first one who actually came in when the mosque was first sort of renovated in 1963, if I recollect correctly from the interview. That is when the first mosque got translated, and he kind of came in 59. He was pretty young at that time, and he had just received his training from Uttar Pradesh, and he had come in. He had some people staying in Mumbai Central, right? And from there, he had been shifted to Dharavi, to this particular mosque. So different people have different memories and different timelines as to how they describe it. So it was very interesting to talk to different people and kind of then validate, okay, what one person is saying with another. So a lot of people knew each other as well, but in no way that... So the one thing that I followed was I always did interviews, independent interviews. There were no like two people sitting at the same time and talking, or a follow-up from one interview after the other in the same location. So that is something that how I maintain that the memory doesn't get mixed up, and the perspectives are always at least in vacuum at that point. So, yeah.
Yeah, sure. Balbir, I wanted to check with you at what stage of your research you are in, because you said you still have to interview. Yeah. And are you at the second stage of your MPhil, and what is the timeline in terms of submitting thesis?
Okay, yeah. So probably this should be my last week, because I do have a couple of interviews lined up with people who are at the MLA or the MP level now, the politicians, because for me to actually go to them and say something that is, I mean, not very correct to say wouldn't be ideal. And the other thing that we discussed that is between me and the supervisor was also who becomes then relevant to talk to, right? Just because they are an MP and an MLA, do they become relevant to the case? How far are they involved, do you think? And how far they can contribute? And because some of these cases are so sensitive, I also have to look at the sources, because if the wrong person sort of gets involved in the interview trail, the process can, I might have to abandon the case altogether, that this is a contested sort of thing. You cannot just write about it. So yeah, that is certainly the part. I will move into transcription by February 2nd week or so. I've been writing regularly about describing what the case has been, and because a lot of data has been selected from Google Earth images as well as from other forms of maps and development plans and other RTI documents, right? There are also descriptions that are already written about certain plots. The narratives now have to go in a story format. So, I mean, there is transcription work. So I will be analyzing using Atlas TI. So this is something that we were taught in our first semester in our qualitative classes. So I just picked up using Atlas TI regularly. Like for anything that I read, I kind of practiced it on coding it on Atlas, then creating some sort of maps out of it, understanding keyword density and all kind of nitty-gritties in the software. So I've become handy in sort of coding using Atlas TI. So I will continue my analysis using Atlas. I also had one particular aspect about analyzing my data is that so I took up this particular class in my second semester, which I basically encouraged this year's batch as well. So we had this particular course on textual interpretation and discourse analysis at Clicks, which we could take up. And that is where we were basically taught about literary critique, and that how do you basically go about understanding discourses, which became very relevant to me because I was basically mapping a particular kind of discourse of urban transformation from the cases that I selected. So what basically is the work? So we had this particular rubric of work, author, audience, and the universe, where the work automatically became the particular plot, right, that was there. The authors automatically became people who transformed the land directly, who were part of that. The everyday users kind of became the audience. They were the recipients of that transformation at each stage. The universe, of course, became the broader urban transformation space and other perhaps similar cases that became like that were nearby or around or that were happening, right? And this is broadly what my coding sort of strategy is going forward. I didn't really have like an interview protocol per se or a schedule. So the whole idea was to just go meet them, tell them, okay, this is what the study is. I tell them, if you could just like simply start by describing who you are, when you came here, and just explain your experience about staying here. I told them at the outset, if you are comfortable, I would cut you in between conversations to ask you, "Acha, ye data missing hai aapke bolne mein. Can you help me out with that?" So that was the whole conversational tone of those interviews, right, really helped me. And like these people were pretty comfortable because on it, like this is something that I felt as well. And this is something that a social scientist, we were also taught that when a person is actually speaking the truth, right, like he doesn't hesitate twice or thrice while talking those kind of nitty-gritties, right? And like my work from journalism, I've been interviewing people like from a very good time for my stories and other things. So I knew like what to ask, when to ask, and when to stop. So those kind of things actually helped. Of course, there were certain guiding questions in each case, but I never sort of went with a protocol ki, okay, I need to finish these sort of 10 questions that I have. Because when we actually look at narratives and memories, right, we cannot like push certain sort of questions that we have in mind, because there were like countless times where people would just like say something, and for 5 minutes they would say ki mujhe pata nahi if this is relevant to your study, but I would like to say this from my experience. So those kind of things actually helped. And of course, like there were field notes, diary notes, and all of that I was continuously maintaining with my interviews. Yeah, okay. So particularly with regards to caste and religion, right? So the first thing that we were looking at, so of course, this is something that we have put in the limitation as well. And also looking at issues of gender, for example, to that caste, religion, and of course, gender plays a very fundamental role in ownership of land, right? And land access. So we were, because the primary objectives were firstly that what does this reveal about urban transformation per se? So, and secondly, implications for sports. So the determinants that we kind of picked up in land were related to ownership, were related to uses, right? Were related to aspects of how did those uses change? What kind of groups then occupied? What happened when a land from rural to urban, like what happened to a land when it got transferred from rural to urban? And in that process, how did those users change? How much information we could capture? So in that way, if interviewers were mentioning that, okay, we belong to a particular group, a particular occupation, it was made note of, it was made a note of, but no, I mean, owning, and so these particular plots, right? I mean, like, I reiterate that because this kind of partially answers the question, right? Because a lot of these lands, right? So whether it's the case of Dharavi, the Dharavi land is a municipal corporation land, which is issued on a rental basis to whosoever owns it. It is owned by a trust. The case with regards to the Thane police ground is owned by a state authority. The case with, for example, the Meera Bhayandar ground is again owned by, of course, it's a contested title. It's a CRZ land. So the Agri Koli community have a native stake in the land, but of course they don't have legal titles to it. Most of them do in that very particular plot, that, but a land title itself is not clear because there are multiple subplots within that large plot where the club is constructed. So, I mean, the ownership right over here, of course, the selection criteria wasn't bound by any sort of religion or caste dominant group occupying certain lands particularly, because we were trying to understand typology. Because when you look at slums, right, and of course, like when it comes to issues of housing or when it comes to stuff related to formal and informal ways in that, I mean, caste does play a role because then you look at income levels and all of that. But the cases that I eventually ended up selecting were representative of the nature of the physical nature, right? And the diversity in that physical nature that MMR sort of represented. Of course, in an MPhil study and with the time frame I had, of course, I cannot basically match everything. So, which is why I picked up one large open space. I picked up one case where I had a 5-star club. I picked up one where I had a sports complex. I picked up one which was in an informal settlement. And I picked up one that was, owned by the state, for example. I mean, like this, these were broadly that things that I could come up with. And of course, there's enormous sort of potential to actually move into understanding these kinds of interlinks and perhaps even add more variables to it, sub variables and so on and so forth. But yeah, I mean, to like fix ourselves to understanding, okay, this notion of, okay, access of land based on particular caste and religious groups becomes very difficult. As to begin with, to identify cases, one has to like have a stratified sampling moving into this. So that is not something that I had, and it is one way. Gender is of course one of the limitations as well, and also a challenge that I face, which is why particularly the Mumbra case, right, the Mumbra sports complex is specifically a case where there's this particular NGO called Parcham. Parcham has been fighting for safe open spaces for girls in Mumbra, right? And Mumbra, like predominantly, is a Muslim settlement in Thane. And there have been a lot of systematic challenges for girls to play over there. And that is something that has come up from the interviews. I'm not saying something that is from my end. This is something that people who have been working at Parcham have explained to me, and also something that have been mentioned by them in the newspaper interviews. TISS themselves did a documentary on them a couple of years back, the Media School of Media and Cultural Studies. So one of the things that were asked, told me in my proposal presentation was also this, that you should also look at women's access to these spaces, right? And which is the precise reason I picked this up. And this also became a case for political patronage, because this NGO get access to land, right? For land or basically a playing space, they went to the MLA who was there. And that MLA has been constantly sort of using this as a tool, as an opportunity, right? And that is a public land. And because the question of land over here is, a lot of I guess all of my cases, I can say it with certainty to some end, except for, barring for one, which is the Meera Bhayandar case, all of them are public grounds, like public in the true sense, right? Like it's a state-owned facility. It's not something that is bound by caste or religion. So, I mean, the reason why we have open spaces are because they are public. Of course, I can further study into what caste and what religion groups do. How does the everyday use then change, right? But because I'm studying transformations and not one particular time frame, the issue becomes because different places are at different stages of their transformation, depending on where they are also located. So, I mean, what I'm today seeing as a Thane police ground could well in turn become a garden and a sports complex 20 years down the line. So, I mean, I don't really know, and I cannot speculate further about its uses. But of course, like access to this land, everyday use can account for caste and religion, but owning is something that was all entirely public. Of course, the only case that Meera Bhayandar, which is a private land, is owned by an upper caste, if I have to state that. So, I mean, of course, that is certainly there. And I hope this per se doesn't change my or affect, has implications in my method, because a large part of it is dealt with understanding what gets identified, I mean, as land as well, right? How do you process sort of, what is the process by which, I mean, land becomes part of this transformation sort of timeline which we talk about? And of course, nothing is linear, that X happens, so Y will happen, which is why we like thought of doing this in the first place.
So, Balbir, I have something to tell you. So, I like the transformation video that you have shown. Mm-hmm. It's been really wonderful. Then the second thing from my personal experience also, so there is a cricket ground that was set up closer to my home, like in Tiruvananthapuram, Kerala. So, and India, West Indies, the matches were played. It is a recent cricket ground. And what happened is that after the match play, there was no international matches. So it was open to the public, as you said, for membership. But as you rightly pointed out, it was very expensive, even for a middle-class family. So I didn't opt for it. So that is something that I could connect during your presentation. And thirdly, only last week we were introduced to educational research methodology, and we were asked to come up with questions. And we were asked to do literature review. And you were telling that for one year you did your literature review. So the question is, do you first come up with the question, then do the literature review on it? Or it's like, do the literature review and then have questions?
I mean, so the thing was, so I was already like read into some sort of, because I was I'm a sports enthusiast. Okay, the precise reason that very briefly answer, I'm interested in working in sports, okay, down the line. So this is what my motivation was, and I regularly read about sports, like almost hopefully every aspect of understanding sports, whatever it was. So I was already versed with where the sports literature currently stands, but I didn't have any training in geography, nor in urban studies, nor with regards to that. So I just basically picked up because I was a student of public policy, I was trained in the legal and policy aspects of land. And I was trained in the legal and policy aspects of politics that was there. So I kind of knew, okay, where the lists are, what kind of work that goes into it, what kind of authorities are relevant to it. So then just picking up literature, right? Like just going into the test library, picking up each book that is written on Bombay, right? Then going and picking up literature that is written about Meera Bhayandar specifically about specific corporations and their issues, for example, looking at information. So within that time frame, like, so once I read all of that, like in the first 6-7 odd months, and because I was reading about it, all my assignments, right, like in my first semester and in my second semester, I almost linked everything to my MPhil thesis dissertation. So like those readings, right, that I was doing, which weren't relevant directly, I kind of used it in my assignment. So I mean, like, that is how, like, I'm new to the interdisciplinary field. I never studied interdisciplinary stuff, and I was pretty young, so I didn't have a lot of experience as to, like, going into a big university like this as well. So I had to, like, scratch for opportunities to actually understand, okay, what is where. So I figured out, okay, if I first read all the literature on Bombay and then move into the organizations that are working. So I read everything, kind of then looked at, okay, this is an organization, this Kanam is repeating, or this is an organization, this is a person whose name is repeating a lot in literature. So, I mean, I used to speak with my guide. She used to tell ki, "Acha, did you speak to that person? Did you speak to this person?" So that is how I got to know a lot more names. And honestly, I had a lot of contacts really in politics with regards to elections, with regards to commissioners in different corporations, their public relations officers, NGOs, because I was working in journalism and because I'm a native of Bombay. I've been staying here, like, I'm 23 and I've been staying here for my entire life. So I literally know everyone and I'm seeing those places physically. It's not something that I'm coming from the outside and seeing them first on the map. I've seen those places. I mean, like, I never noticed them as I've done so in the past 2 years. But yeah, like, I did see them and kind of, like, just picked up, right? Ki, okay, once I did the 7 months of extensive reading with the literature that was there, and I looked at only literature in Mumbai, because Mumbai itself has been written about so much, right? You don't have to go about reading something about a Bangalore airport for transformation. I mean, you have like an entire line of literature when it comes to the new airport coming up in New Bombay, or when the Terminal 2 was coming up in Mumbai. So if you want to actually read about it, just go about like finding the government document, the policy and the land reservation for that. So, I mean, like, that focus on, so, I mean, there could be, I mean, limitations to it, but at least I didn't figure out when I was actually collecting information from the fieldwork, I didn't really realize ki, okay, what I already knew was inadequate from the literature itself. And the only the good positive feedback that I got was from the people when the proposal presentation was there, that I'd already done a very extensive field work on my lit review, and I didn't really have a lot of suggestions to that end. So the only suggestion that was added was firstly to delimit it because of the pandemic. But luckily, because I was in Bombay, I had to change nothing. So just the timeline got pushed and I was able to complete a lot of it. And the second thing was per se to like incorporate this case about female access to land. So which is why I particularly picked up this case in Mumbra, where Parcham is this NGO and who's fighting, and they had all these popular sort of struggles, issues between sisters who were playing and unke brothers were sort of creating a menace in the field when they were playing. So all of those kind of issues did come up. So, I mean, your research questions, right, could be guiding your inquiry. But your literature selection should primarily be pretty blanket at first. I mean, the location. So you should like to be thorough about, okay, if somebody is talking about a theme in Bombay, I should at least know, okay, what that person is talking about. I may not have read, okay, all books by Banerjee Guha, for example, right? Or for example, any other person who has R.N. Sharma, but I know, okay, what they have written about, and then just select, okay, this is what is relevant to me and this is not. I mean, like, that just helped me. I mean, I don't know, like, in another context, probably. Yeah, so I just basically picked up a lot of things that were taught in the class as well. As I mentioned, right, I picked up something that was taught in the first semester with regards to Atlas TI, in the second semester that I was taught with regards to textual interpretation. So I am not a very big person on reading fiction, but when I actually read literary critique, it really helped me a lot, because to understand how does narrative fiction work. And that helped me understanding, okay, how does memories and narrative play a role in placemaking, which helped me in like in my research method as well. So, I mean, yeah, like there was a good back and forth in between, of course. Like I believe honestly, up till August, I had no clue about what my cases would look like. But then my supervisor sort of forced me into, Balbi, you just select these five cases, whatever these five cases you want. She told me three, I insisted on five, that I would be able to do it. Yeah, and like we kind of have delivered on that promise. And yeah, so I mean, like we just move into like these cases, talking to people. And yeah, like that was basically my thing. Like I do this every day. It's like a regular process. Wake up in the morning, just call up everyone on the list. Ki sir, aaj aap free ho kya baat karne ke liye? Like as simple as that. So I mean, that was my sort of process too. So they also were interested. Ki, okay, this is one person who is like there and he wants to know stuff. So teesri baar nahi, fourth time they would pick up the call. And these people, and the only advantage that I had was these aren't people who are affected by the pandemic in any way. They aren't migrant workers or they aren't people who are economically affected. They were pretty much in their families. They were watching TV all along and they had their stuff. Okay. So, I mean, the ethical considerations only came in when it came to the legal and illegal aspects, which is something that I also made clear in a way ki I'm not focusing on that. My value position is neutral here. You can say whatever you want. I will also speak to the other side who says ki I haven't destroyed mangroves and this is a completely legal project, which of course the official documents show. So, I mean, the environmental activists have a different perspective. So, the idea was to capture those perspectives over time so as to map the transformation. So yeah, I mean,
I think thank you so much, Balveer. I think it was a wonderful presentation and thank you for sharing your insights. I think it's really helpful. I think and